The wise virgins understood the assignment. Be ready to celebrate the wedding. Now, when I first read this passage, a parable many years ago, I was puzzled because, you know, I was like, wait a second. Is the bridegroom got five wives? Like, what is happening here? We don't believe in polygamy. And so I was very kind of confused about this parable. But then I started to learn about Jewish marriage customs at the time of Jesus. And I was like, oh, that makes a lot more sense. So let's go through that a little bit. Let's remind ourselves of that. So when a couple was going to get married, there was a betrothal ceremony. But they wouldn't live together. They would be considered married, but they wouldn't live together for about a year as the husband was preparing and getting everything ready. And we see this with Joseph and Mary, right? They're betrothed, but don't live together. And this is when the angel Gabriel comes to Mary, announces this, the good news of the incarnation. But then at the wedding time, there'd be this procession where the bridegroom goes and gets the bride and brings him back to his own home for a week-long celebration with friends and family, a week-long celebration of the wedding. So imagine, you know, in modern days, let's kind of put this in modern terms for a minute so we can kind of enter into the, like, oh yeah, that's not good. Imagine in today's terms, if you were asked to be a bridesmaid, close friend, and you knew for a year in advance that the wedding was happening, but instead of being ready, going to all the stuff, you showed up 40 minutes late to the wedding in sweatpants and a t-shirt covered with cheese ball stains. Who's ready to party? What would the couple say? Like, who are you? I thought we were friends. I don't even know you. Like, I don't even know you anymore. Right? They'd be such an act of disrespect, such a narcissistic act. They might even be tempted to lie. Well, no, I got into an accident with a cheese ball truck and a sweatpants truck, and this is all that I had. No. Why? Why would they be tempted to lie? Because the truth is terrible, right? Yeah, I just didn't really care enough about this to be on time. Yeah, you know, what were you doing? I was just sitting on the couch like a potato on my phone. Yikes. Right? It'd be such an act of selfishness, such an act of a lack of love. You'd just be like, what are you doing? Right? And so now we bring this, you know, now we've kind of dove into this parable a little bit, bring this back to Jesus's day. Right? And Jesus, throughout this part of the gospel, the end of Matthew's gospel, he's talking about these three different realities that are deeply interconnected. One, he's talking about his own coming to earth to rescue the bride, right? His incarnation, his mission right then and there. He's talking about the end of the world where he will come back to judge the living and the dead. And he's talking about our own lives, our own, when we will meet the Lord, when we will encounter the Lord on judgment day. And for centuries, let's look at the first one. For centuries, he had been prophesying about the time when the Messiah would come, when God would come rescue his people, give his life, bear the sins of his people, right? Prophet after prophet after prophet preparing the way. Even the friend of the bridegroom, St. John the Baptist, sent by God to prepare the way immediately. And Jesus shows up, arrives, works mighty miracles, and preaches amazing things. And do they welcome him? Are they ready for him? No, they yell, crucify him. Right? Their fire had gone out. Their devotion to God had gone out. Caught up in, no, we just want an earthly kingdom with earthly power. Like, you're doing something different from us. Thanks, but no thanks, right? And they reject him. And so he's telling them, watch, you know, trying to prepare them, trying to wake them up to this reality. And of course, they did not want to wake up. They wished to stay asleep. They wished to stay spiritually dead. Now, Jesus, of course, is tying right before this and after, talking explicitly about the end of the world as well. Tells right before this about the master of the house will return at an unknown day and an unknown hour. And talks about the faithful servant, the faithful and wise servant who is waiting for the master's return, who is being faithful to his tasks, doing his job, right? It says, blessed is that servant who his master, when he comes, finds him doing so. Truly, I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions. And so what would be our response, right? We think of, you know, we think of this reality that the world is going to end. What is our response? If you knew the world was going to end in 5, 4, 3, 2, is there something in your heart that's like, woohoo? Or is there something in your heart that's like, oh no? If it's, oh no, confessions are tomorrow at 8 a.m., right? And so this is the whole thing, right? Are we ready at any moment? And what do we need to be ready? We need sanctifying grace. We need the grace of salvation. Our hearts have to be on fire with the Holy Spirit. If we don't have sanctifying grace in our hearts, if we're not literally supernaturally alive, I'm not talking about I just believe God exists. I'm talking about supernaturally alive that only happens through baptism, or if we've lost it through serious sin and it only takes one mortal sin by going to confession. Right? Are we supernaturally alive? And there are so many people, so many Catholics, sadly, who are not ready. They think, well, you know, I'll do that later. Like, yeah, those, you know, those who think they'll repent at the 11th hour might die a quarter till. Right? And the Lord is warning us. He's warning us, like, be ready. Why? Because you actually care, right? Like, if we care about the Lord, if we care about the bridegroom, we're going to say, I want to order my life in line with that caring versus the narcissistic bridesmaid that's like, I don't really care. I'll show up when I feel like it, and they better be grateful I show up at all. Like, yikes. Right? Like, you think of time where this was years ago, so I'm not throwing anybody, you don't know this person, where I had a conversation with the person about showing up super late for Mass. And his response to me was, Father, you should be grateful I show up at all. I was like, yeah, this is not about me. I'm asking you to reconsider how you're treating the Lord. This isn't about whether you're making me happy. I'm concerned about how you're treating the Lord, and I'm asking you to reconsider your actions here. Right? And so that type of selfishness that we can get into that says, you should be grateful I show up at all. It's like, are you here to serve the Lord? Or are you here for a pat on the back, right? Like, and so this is then that specific challenge to be wise with our own lives. Are we wise or foolish with the precious time that we have on this earth to prepare for heaven, to become saints? This is the goal, right? To be radically alive with the grace and love of God, to live with him, to love him with all our hearts, mind, and strength, to love our neighbors, ourselves, to serve him faithfully. This is the purpose. Communion with God, living for God, this is the purpose. And when we get to the end of our lives, no one on this earth will think, I wish I had spent more time with my phone. I wish I had spent more time relaxing on the couch watching TV. No one's going to think that way. They're going to think, I wish I had loved God more and served him better. I wish I had helped my kids learn more about God and get to heaven and care about the faith. Right? And you think of this with parenting, right? You have a limited amount of time with your kids. Are you preparing them to become saints or professional athletes? Oh, Father. Yeah, well. Gotta throw a little guilt trip in there, right? It's not a guilt trip. It's only a guilt trip if it applies. And so this is the invitation of the Lord, right? To make sure that we know the purpose of our lives, that we're not wasting our lives on things beneath us, things beneath our dignity, things that are not worth our time as beloved children of God, and letting those things, those lesser things, get in the way of preparing and becoming a saint and being filled with grace, the things that can actually satisfy, the things that can actually bring life. Not to go chasing after the dirt of the earth, but go running after the Lord of heaven and earth. Now, one of the people that did this with her life, I want to talk just briefly about her, is St. Elizabeth of the Trinity. So when St. Elizabeth, she grew up in France about 100 years ago, and, you know, as a young lady, she, you know, a very talented young lady, had marriage proposals, but she turned them all down because she wanted to live for God. When she was about 17, she went to the monastery there, which was just near her house, the Carmelite monastery there. And the Mother Superior said, listen, you got to read this circular letter, this biography of this sister that just died.
Sister Therese of Lisieux, right? What we know now to be the story of soul. This is a year after she had died. And so St. Elizabeth of the Trinity read the story of the soul, read the writings of St. Therese, and was like, this is what it's about. Pursuing the mystical life, pursuing a deep prayer life. This is the call of my life. And you know what happened? When she told her mom at 17, she's like, I want to become a nun. I want to enter the Carmel. Even though the Carmel that she entered was 200 meters from her home, her mom said, no, you can't do that. I forbid it. And got into this whole back and forth. And finally, as she saw her persevering, her mom said, you have to wait until you're at least 21, right? Thinking that maybe she would change her mind. And St. Elizabeth persevered, was involved with catechizing troubled youth, and was, didn't just sit there, stare at a wall, was serving the church. But then she finally entered and became a Carmelite nun, dedicating her whole life to pursuing Christ in prayer, experiencing powerful, transforming graces. So by the time she died at 26, which was 5 years as a nun, was already canonizable as a great saint in the mystical life. She died of Addison's disease, a tragic disease, a very painful disease that didn't have much treatments for at all. She knew about the grace of this is what it's about, living a life with the Trinity in my soul, growing in holiness, growing in sanctifying grace, abiding in the infinite love of God. This is what it's about. And she ordered everything towards that purpose, whatever God's call was in her life, right? And so we are called to do the same, whether our vocation is priesthood or religious life or married life, to say, this is the goal, to be a saint, to be on fire with love of God, to love, know and love and serve him in this life and spend eternity with him in heaven. And I don't want to do just the bare minimum, hoping I kind of just squeak my way into purgatory. I want to go for the gold here. I want to go for the heavenly crown. I want to live totally for him, and I'm going to order everything towards that. Because I don't want to run out of oil. Because I don't want to make it to the finish line and fail right before the finish line because I wasn't prepared, because I took it for granted. It said, there'll be time to repent. There'll be time to do that later. There'll be time to grow in holiness later. I'll do that later. Right now, I'm about this. Yeah. What does that say about our friendship with the Lord? No, we don't want to do that to him. Now, this, as I mentioned at the beginning of Mass, this is a call by name Sunday, where we think about vocations and we think about, the people in our lives, family members, friends who may be being called by God to the priesthood, to the religious life, to the permanent diaconate, right? Maybe having a call from God to dedicate their lives to him in an exclusive way. We, of course, know that God, people that are married, people that are consecrated, single people can dedicate their lives, live for God, of course. But we know that God does call some people to live complete, exclusive lives dedicated to him in a life of celibacy as a priest or a nun. And so I want you to, we're going to take some time in a minute just to be thinking about this. But those young people who are here, I've mentioned this before. Does God have your permission to call you to religious life or the priesthood? Can you make a blank check for God that says, God, I'll do whatever you ask. You may be a priest. You want me to get married? You want to be a monk? You want me to be a nun? Whatever it is, you say it, I'll do it. Right? Does God have your permission to call? Or are we kind of being tempted, maybe like, does God have permission to call your kid to the priesthood or religious life? Oh, no, Father, I want those grandbabies. Today's the day to say, Lord, you can take all because you give all. Lord, you can take all. Because you give all, and I trust you. Whatever you want for my life, I just want to say yes. I want to end with just a couple quotes from St. Elizabeth of the Trinity, since they're so good.
He says, and this kind of relates to the gospel, the Trinity, this is our dwelling, our home, the Father's house that we must never leave. Right? The people in the wedding, they weren't ready, so they left the Father's house. We don't want to do that. And she said this, believe that he loves you. He wants to help you himself in the struggles with which you must undergo. Believe in his love, his exceeding love. St. Elizabeth of the Trinity, pray for us.